FDCI, and I will let our moderators, and in particular, Peter Roscher from Reed Smith, introduce AFDCI. So the topic of this Francophone session is construction arbitration in Francophone Africa, the role of state courts, interim measures and enforcement issues. You'll have as moderators Peter Roscher and Christoph Lapp. Peter Roscher is the global head of international arbitration at Reed Smith, and Christoph Lapp is a partner at Advent Altana Paris. Peter, can I hand over to you? Can you hear us?
Of course, I can hear you. Can you all hear me?
Oh, and we can't hear you yet, Peter. Are you on mute?
No.
Oh, now we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you. Yeah, we can.
Okay, great. Okay, well,
so I'll hand over to you.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Well, good afternoon, Lagos. And good afternoon to those participating remotely. It's a great pleasure for me and for Christoph to have been invited to moderate this panel, which is a panel organized by the Africa Construction Law, but in conjunction with the French Association for Construction Law and Real Estate Law, the AFDCI, and that is the French chapter of the Society of Construction Law, which has been set up fairly recently. This afternoon, we're going to be looking at some important aspects of construction arbitration in Francophone Africa. With Christoph, we have divided this session into two parts. The first part, which I will moderate, is going to focus on the role of state courts before the arbitral tribunal is constituted, and after it has been constituted in relation to such things as interim measures. And then the second part, which will be moderated by Christoph, will focus on enforcement issues in Francophone Africa. We're going to be speaking in English, which might seem a little bit strange for something that is to do with Francophone Africa. There were a number of reasons for that, but we have said to all of the panelists that if there are certain things that they want to express in French, or if any of the audience or those participating virtually want to ask questions or make comments in French, faites-le, il n'y aura pas de problème par rapport à ça, et on peut très bien interpréter pour ceux qui ne parlent pas français, donc il n'y aura pas de problème. Before we move on to each of the two parts of this session, I'll start by just very briefly introducing our panelists. And I'll start with our two panelists from OHADA jurisdictions, Khaled Abu El Houda, who is registered with the Bar Association in Senegal and the Ivory Coast. And Khaled is managing partner of Houda Law Firm, and he has over two decades of practice in business law and dispute resolution across a range of industries, including mining, oil and gas, and energy. We also are joined by Serge Martin Zeng, who is a lawyer at the Cameroon Bar Association. Serge is the managing partner of Zeng Partners Law Firm, and Serge also has over two decades of experience as a lawyer in business law dispute resolution, and in particular, has dealt with issues relating to enforcement of arbitral awards in Cameroon. Serge is the Cameroon representative for Africa Construction Law. We then have Leu Tamaru, who is a legal consultant and independent arbitrator. And Leu was the founder of IARB Africa. Leu is a court member of the ICC for Ethiopia and a member of the ICC African Committee in Paris. And if you look at all of the directors, Leu is somebody to watch. He's regularly reported as being a rising star by Africa Arbitration. Fourth, we have thrown into the mix a lawyer from a non-Francophone African jurisdiction who is actually sitting on the panel in Lagos. That's Robert Thackwell, who is a counsel Alan over in Johannesburg and concentrates on construction dispute resolution, including arbitration. Robert will act very much as a comparator in relation to some of the Francophone jurisdictions this afternoon. Just before moving on to the first part of this session, I would say that Christophe and I, and when I was counting this, Christophe, we've got more than five decades, and actually we're probably nearer six decades of experience combined, not individually, in construction arbitration. Christophe is a partner with Advent Altana in Paris, with a wealth of experience in construction arbitration. I'm a partner at Reed Smith, and I've been based in Paris for over 25 years, and also focusing on construction arbitration as well. So if we move on now to the first part of this panel, which is a discussion about the role of state courts in Francophone Africa. And I've divided this with the panel into three different aspects. The first is looking at that role in before the constitution of the arbitral tribunal. And one big theme is to what extent state courts support and assist the, actually, could we move on to the slides, please, and put up the first slide? If somebody is working the slides, if not, we'll do it without slides. Okay, we'll do it without slides. So the first question is really, to what extent state courts support and assist the conduct of arbitration before the arbitral tribunal is in place? And if they do, to what extent? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go out, first of all, to Leu to talk about the Ethiopian context.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Peter. I wish I was in Lagos with all of you today, but unfortunately, I'm still in Addis. And if you're wondering why Ethiopia has been included in a Francophone list, it's mainly for this particular reason. Our legal system was very much influenced by the French, our drafters of the civil code and many of the different laws that we actually currently use today, the civil procedure code and others, were French comparatist lawyers. So a lot of that comes from France and in the continental system. So because of that, we have a lot more in common with our Francophone African countries than we do than our Anglophone countries. So that's kind of why I'm in this mix today. Now coming back to the point that Peter raised, well, the first important thing is Ethiopia just recently signed the New York Convention, and we you know, which is great news for the arbitration community. But moving forward, not only did we just come on board to the New York Convention, we also recently came enacted a new arbitration, what we call the Arbitration and Conciliation Working Proclamation, which really is it's ancestral law based, ancestral model law based, but it's also a huge change to our legal system and really a move forward towards being a more arbitration-friendly environment jurisdiction. Now, when it comes to pre-constitution of arbitral tribunal, you will notice that our law actually is a lot more, removed, requires the courts to really be removed from the arbitral process. Now, and this is from a legal perspective. So this is, you know, when you strictly look at the laws, that's actually what it is. Previously, in our previous practices, our courts were very, let's say, jealous of the arbitral proceeding because they felt that they were kept out and wanted to be part of it. But what we've seen with a lot of the trends that I've seen come up, and especially what this law really reflects, this new law reflects, is our courts are required to be, removed from the arbitral process. So an application to the courts pre-constitution of arbitral tribunal does not mean you forfeit your right to the arbitration agreement. Courts are very respectful. In fact, there's only very few grounds upon which the courts would continue entertaining this action before the court. And the main one is if the arbitral agreement is void. And one of the grounds upon which the arbitral agreement becomes void is if it's not raised in the preliminary objection that there is an arbitration agreement between the parties. So then that would be considered as the party forfeiting its right to go to arbitration. So that's the first thing. And when we move forward to the constitution of the arbitral tribunal, I mean, you know, parties aren't exactly appointing arbitrators, and the courts have to be appointing arbitrators. This is a very new practice for us, for courts to be appointing arbitrators. And what I can say is ECIPA has an extensive experience in courts and next mediations. And in doing these court and next mediations, and these court and next mediations first started off with family law related matters that have now slowly moved to business, and some of which are actually, construction cases. We've seen the courts develop a list with private sector, with chambers of commerce, other training institutes, a list. So it's just a matter of a very short time before I'm sure we develop a list of arbitrators that courts can actually appoint. I've had the opportunity and the honor of training over almost 200 judges from the Federal Supreme Court, Federal High Court, and this was a discussion that we've actually had to say, okay, we need to be able to have a list because we can't just appoint anybody, particularly in cases, large cases and whatnot. And the other point that we've actually also discussed during these trainings is having a separate bench for arbitration related cases. The High Court is the de facto first instance court for arbitration. Our understanding is because there's a specialized knowledge requirement, and Ethiopia has a lot of construction related disputes, that we have a separate bench. And so this is on the agenda, and I'm really hoping that this will, be addressed at some point, and we'll see the impact of these discussions I've had with the judges.
Okay, thanks very much, Lou. I mean, perhaps now if we move across to Serge and just ask what the position is in Cameroon and to what extent state courts are arbitration-friendly, interventionist, and also something that Leo just mentioned about the way the courts will assist in the constitution of the arbitration itself if one of the parties is not playing ball.
Thank you so much. I'm going to use the possibility which has been given to me and to say the French language. So I'm going to speak in French.
Of course.
Sous le droit WADA, le juge étatique, as you will to say it in our context, intervient principalement sur deux aspects. Il intervient, on le qualifie de juge d'appui. Juge d'appui à la constitution du juge d'appui à l'arbitral. Ensuite, il est le juge des mesures provisoires et conservatoires. C'est principalement dans ce champ-là qu'on voit l'intervention du juge étatique. Et elle est particulièrement heureuse et d'expérience. Cette intervention, effectivement, vise à aider dans la mise en œuvre de l'arbitrage, tant dans le rôle, dans son rôle comme juge étatique, comme juge d'appui. C'est-à-dire une partie ne veut manifestement pas aider à la constitution du tribunal arbitral et la partie qui va intenter, qui va engager la procédure va saisir le juge. Et généralement, c'est le juge, dans notre contexte camerounais, du tribunal de première instance, à l'effet de voir désigner l'arbitre, de prendre des mesures qui s'imposent afin que le tribunal arbitral soit constitué et que la procédure soit lancée. Bon, ensuite, on va aborder certainement plus loin cette autre compétence très utile dans l'encadrement et qui est souvent même le déclencheur de la procédure arbitrale, la possibilité qui est donnée et reconnue à ce juge étatique de prendre des mesures conservatoires. Parce que très souvent, une partie, avant d'engager la procédure, parce qu'elle coûte quand même cher, voudra parfois s'assurer qu'au terme de la procédure, lorsqu'elle reviendra pour une force, il y a des assets, des actifs qu'elle aura neutralisés. Donc très souvent, ce qui se voit le plus en termes de mesures conservatoires, c'est des saisies conservatoires, soit des créances, soit des biens meubles corporels ou de tout autre actif. That's what I can say at this moment.
Okay, thank you. And to what extent, if the parties cannot agree on the constitution of the arbitral tribunal in Cameroon, to what extent would the courts assist the parties, and do they have a list of arbitrators? How does that operate?
The courts do not have a list of arbitrators, regretfully. But what will generally happen? What will generally happen is that in Cameroon we have now 3 arbitration centers. I will say the people practicing arbitration are well known. Those arbitration centers have their own list of arbitration, and the judge will generally rely on the list which are provided and which are made public by those 3 arbitration centers. But it is not an obligation. The principle remains that the judge has, it's like a discretionary power for the judge to appoint who he seems to be fit for this assignment.
Okay. And so if we move across now to look at sort of Senegal and the Ivory Coast, and if I sort of put the same issues to Khaled for your views.
Yes, Peter, thank you. Yes, in addition to Serge, intervention, I can confirm that, you know, Cameroon, Senegal, Cote d'Ivoire, and 14 countries with Senegal, Cote d'Ivoire, and Cameroon has the same uniform act applicable to arbitration. So this uniform act on several articles and provision fix the limits of the state courts and the power of the state courts and the arbitration tribunal. So it's important at this time, I think, in addition what Serge says, that you have mainly 2 articles. The first, you know, which is in my view important, is the Article 13 of the Uniform Act of Arbitration, putting the national court in front of an obligation. They are committed to respect all the will of all the parties in the arbitration procedure. So this could fix you about the risk and the limits between the arbitration tribunal, which is not already formed, and the role of the state court. So if the 2 parties are agreed and appear in front of a state jurisdiction without making any objection, at this time the state court could be competent. But if one party is objecting and opposing the arbitration clause, at this time the national court and the state court will be incompetent. So this article fixes the rules and the role of the state court and the arbitration court. Another article, the 11th article of the same Uniform Act, give and establish the principle of competence of the arbitration tribunal. It means that the tribunal will be able to fix and to rule its own jurisdiction, and no power has been reserved to the state court. So I think that for, you know, through this panel, the purpose with me and Serge is to clarify and to give more information about our applicable rule through this act uniform of arbitration applicable on these 17 countries of OADA region.
Okay, thank you. And we'll come back and look at that particular, as well as the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration, when we move on to look at interim measures. Perhaps, Theremin, if we just go to Rob and as our comparator, and how does this compare with South Africa?
Yeah, thank you for the question. It compares quite favorably, I would say, to South Africa. South African courts are certainly non-interventionist, inherently non-interventionist, I would say. The tradition of arbitration has been evolving steadily over the last couple of decades. And I think we've got to a point where our courts rarely interfere. There are very few grounds in which the state courts, or very few reasons for which the state courts will get involved in arbitration. I think the speaker before me, Michael Cooper, spoke about the International Arbitration Act that was passed in South Africa 4 years ago. you know, that's a sign of this evolving culture of arbitration and non-interference. So that would be, I would see it as an arbitration-friendly district. and the jurisprudence and the case law that's coming out of our courts certainly suggests that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Well, maybe if we move on and we just look at the next aspect. So unfortunately, we haven't got the slides up, but we're going to turn to look at interim measures and the role of state courts. And it's looking at interim measures after the constitution of the tribunal. So previously, Serge touched on the role before the tribunal itself is in place. But let's look at what happens once the arbitral tribunal is in place and the extent to which provisional or interim measures could be ordered by state courts in order to aid the arbitration, the conduct of the arbitration. I mean, you touched on before the Uniform Act of Arbitration, and I know that there are certain limits that are imposed by that. There's a proviso that the state courts can assist, provided they do not review the merits. That's my understanding. And then, of course, under the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration, there's another proviso which says that once the arbitral tribunal is in place, state courts can exceptionally be asked to make provisional measures, provided the proviso there is that you can satisfy the urgency test. So with that kind of background, I mean, if I go out first of all to Leibat and looking at Ethiopia, that has this sort of French influence, I mean, to what extent can parties request interim measures from the national courts after the arbitral tribunal is in place?
You know, so like I said, this is a very new law. And although our previous law was very much, you know, it came in 1960, our civil procedure code came out in the 1960s, and that's about a mere 2 years after the New York Convention. And, you know, the drafters were quite inspired by the New York Convention at that point. So it was quite arbitration friendly, but you know, this new practice that we're you know, our courts, I'm sure, are going to pivot along for a few years on a few cases, but I'm sure we'll get it right. There's, you know, there's clear provisions.
Leu, it's cutting out a little bit. Sorry.
Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Perfect. I was just saying I'm sure our courts will get it right because, again, the training is there and the willingness is there and the awareness is there, is that parties have the potential to go to courts for interim measures, precautionary measures, for the collection of evidence, for precautionary measures, for security purposes. All of these allow these that courts could have done previously. You know, one of the things that the arbitral tribunal on its own can actually even do is attach, you know, to protect assets or to preserve assets, or even if there are perishable goods, to make sure.
Leu, I'm sorry to say, yes? It's cutting out a little bit. I think you've got a chair. I think you're just going to have to.
I'm just going to have to be straight. Okay, I'm very sorry. but yeah, so you know, the tribunal, the arbitral tribunal itself, can actually attach and even describe this perishable goods, and anything that requires the preserve, whether assets or any material that would be necessary in the process of the arbitration. And the courts are also have provided. I mean, it's the fact that the law requires, the law recognizes that the arbitral tribunal can even go as far as attachment is actually a really big recognition and really big move in the right direction. I would say in our laws, there is an emergency requirement in order for the tribunal to provide an interim measure. It does require, it states that considering that irreparable damage is likely to happen, that aspect is required for the order to be put forward. Now, yes, there is a time limit on interim measures, especially the precautionary interim measures. There's a 30-day consecutive limit, which I believe can be renewed. and or can be lifted early upon, and the parties will have to communicate that to the arbitral tribunal. Now, you know, the other thing is, you know, there the law makes a clear separation between order and arbitration. An interim measure and arbitration award are two separate things, and their enforcement are actually quite separate. And the good thing is the enforcement of interim measures is quite simple and is actually very good. So that's very positive result.
Okay, thank you. I mean, perhaps if we move and Khaled, if you could perhaps sort of deal with that aspect in your jurisdictions in relation to interim measures, to what extent
yes.
courts can assist after the tribunal has been put in place.
Yes, as explained, I think we have the same system, because the provisional measures could be asked by the diligent party to the judge. So it's mainly presented by a request to the judge of the request in front of the first instance of jurisdictions. And at this time, the diligent party has, you know, by this diligence to secure its own interest by freezing the assets provisionally or the bank accounts of the party, or asking an emergency measures justifying why the party is asking this measure. So it's completely possible, and it's provided by our internal rule in Côte d'Ivoire and in Senegal also. So it's permitted, of course, before we have explained the difference between, I mean, and the limit between the state court and the arbitration court, but this exception is granted by our internal law.
Okay, and just to throw something else in there, I mean, to what extent is it possible for the arbitral tribunal itself to seize a national court in relation to an interim measure as opposed to the parties?
Yes, I mean, the provision measures, when these provision measures are decided by the court, it has, of course, a consequence, but it's not an immediate consequence on the arbitration award. It means that, you know, the provisional measures will be validated by the tribunal of the arbitration tribunal. We have this in one of our last cases. We have taken guarantees on the real estate assets of a debtor on behalf of a bank, and then this provisional measures has been approved and granted by the arbitration tribunal. So it means that the link between the two jurisdictions, first the state court, who is granting a provisional measures, and then this provisional measures is submitted to the arbitration tribunal to see if it's founded or not. This is, in my opinion, you know, the continuation of the procedure. And we have recently been granted by a positive decisions, you know, according the guarantees to the claimant.
Okay, thank you. Serge, from a Cameroon perspective.
Yes, thank you. I will just confirm what Khaled has said, because yes, we are in the matter of OADA law, and secondly, it's a matter of civil procedure law, and generally we almost have the civil the same rules. Yes, it will be possible in case, and that is, I think you have mentioned it, in case of a recognized and reasoned emergency for the state court to order certain provisional measure as far as it does not imply an examination of the merit of the case. In fact, this is the general application of the principles before the summary court, because such applications are made before what you call le juge des référés. And normally, those summary courts do not have competence to go on the substance of the matters.
Okay. Rob, South Africa, is it very different, very similar?
Similar in some respects. I think in a South African context, you need to first consider whether it's domestic arbitration or an international arbitration, which is governed by our International Arbitration Act. The power of courts to order interim measures in a domestic context is actually greater than that in an international arbitration context. They are permitted to grant measures such as security for costs, anti-dissipation orders, discovery, disclosure type orders. We see the same thing in an international arbitration context. However, the state courts can only do so where in an emergency situation. So the state courts do not have jurisdiction unless there is some kind of emergency or the arbitral tribunal is not in a position to grant the interim measure. So in that way, we see a deference towards international arbitration, and that deference is underpinned by the UNCITRAL model law incorporated into South African law via the International Arbitration Act.
Okay, thank you. I mean, just to touch on one last aspect before Christoph deals with enforcement issues, and that's sort of parallel proceedings, but the principle of compétence, and it's something that Khaled mentioned a little bit earlier, and it's sort of how do state courts apply that principle in your particular jurisdiction? And what I'm thinking of there is that sort of my understanding from OADA arbitration law is that principle applies, but it's tempered by an exception. And that exception is that where the judge is seized of a dispute on the basis that the clause containing the arbitration, or that the contract rather containing the arbitration clause, is manifestly null or manifestly unenforceable, they can then underpin and the court can take jurisdiction. And that comes back to another point that I think was raised by Caleb, which is in making that assessment, the court is almost a two-prong approach, because not only does the court have to interpret the clause itself in order to identify whether there's a possible defect, but it seems that they often have to go a little bit further and examine the facts themselves. So perhaps if I could ask, start with Serge on this one. So, you know, to what extent do the state courts apply the principle of compétence, and in what, you know, what are the contours to that?
I will say on this point that nowadays in Cameroon, because personally in my firm, I've been I had cases where I've been trying to challenge the competence of the state court on the basis of arbitration clauses, and where they declared themselves incompetent, we went to the Court of Appeal and then to the Common Court of Arbitration, and we finally won the case. And I also have a case where really that clause was, then I was asking for the claimant, and the clauses were not really well drafted, and I said to the client, okay, let's make the balance. These are the amount of fees which we will pay if we go to arbitration. Let's try before the judicial court to see, and we will plead that the clause is manifestly not, and we try to plead that, and it did not work. So I would say generally, and thanks to the Common Court of Justice and Arbitrations, our courts are actually recognizing that principle. Generally, if you, I would say at 90%, the court are recognizing. In certain cases, in the first instance, we'll have judge which will render not a bad decision, but at the Court of Appeal or at the level of the Common Court of Arbitration, the situation will be resolved.
Okay. Perhaps if we go outside of OADA and Leu, the position in Ethiopia, and then we'll come back to Senegal and the Ivory Coast. Have we lost Leu? Okay. In that case, Khaled, your views, is it similar to Cameroon?
Yes, Peter, completely similar. Okay. And we can add that the Article 13 of the Arbitration Act, Uniform of Arbitration, reinforced the principle of competence by adding a principle of priority, according to which when a state court is seized on the question which has already been the subject of an arbitration agreement, it must declare itself incompetent. So this question, yes, I'm adding just this precision to search comments.
Okay, very much like the French system. And Rob, as our comparator, the South African perspective on this?
Yes, it's a matter of tribe law that tribunals can rule on their own jurisdiction. That's been entrenched for some time now, and that's been reinforced further in the International Arbitration Act, which incorporates the Interpol model law. So I would say the principle is well accepted.
Okay, thank you. Leu, I see that you've come back. It just in sort of a minute or two, because I'm keen to sort of hand over to Christophe to deal with the enforcement issues. Just on competence and the way that that's treated by the national courts in Ethiopia.
You know, the law is quite clear. It says that the arbitration agreement will survive any, even if the contract that it is on is voidable. So that actually, you know, I think it goes into the entire discussion.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for keeping to time. Christophe, I hand over to you for the enforcement issues.
I have some issue. I mute, but I can't cook my mute. I'm sorry. Do you hear me?
Yes.
You hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, good. Yes. I'm sorry, because on my screen, I'm on mute. So thank you. Thank you, Peter. Thank you for the introduction and for giving me the opportunity to share the moderation session with this esteemed panel. And thanks for all the panelists. State courts are called upon any given jurisdiction for a number of issues at all stages of the proceeding, from appointment of arbitrators, interim measures, as explained by you, Peter, and the panelists, or to setting aside an enforcement of a war. This is precisely why it's of utmost importance to have a clear definition of who does what and when. Clarifying this question is crucial today in Africa, particularly insofar as being such a large and promising market for both African and non-African investors, for example. As enforcement is a decisive element of for international arbitration, parties naturally seek to minimize the risk of annulment of the awards by the courts. This is why the party's wish is that the court of the African states be favorable to arbitration in order to choose them a seat of arbitration rather than some European countries, Paris, for example, or Geneva. Today, and since it's known that Africa states offer a diversity of national arbitration laws, our discussion aims at scrutinizing the specificity of each country's provision and comparing them, for example, with South Africa, in order to try to reach the exportable elements from one system to another, or avoidable elements that may hinder the flexibility of arbitration and the choice of some African states as a preferred state. So I propose to begin the question to answer who does what and when. The first question for the panelists, and for Leru, for example, the first, what are the judicial recourses available to the parties in your experience, in your countries, in your practice, once the award has been received? Enforcement, request or the recourse for annulment, or the recourses? For example, in France, we have four recourses. How many for in your countries or in your practice?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Christophe. Well, you know, like I mentioned earlier, Ethiopia is in a very interesting place where we are actually modernizing our system. And at this moment, we find ourselves in a position where we have 3 arbitration repeats. So just to be clear, the current arbitration act is to be used on foreign arbitral awards or domestic arbitral awards that have been, where the agreements have been signed after the coming into force of the arbitration. So this is not for agreements that are going to court today, to be hopefully, because it's only about a year. But there is then the Civil Procedure Code, which is generally going to phase out slowly. And the third is the current arbitration law, you know, provides a clear separation between enforcement of arbitral awards that are foreign and enforcement of arbitral awards that are domestic. So by stating that the intent of the law is to make it so that because we've signed the New York Convention, that enforcement and recognition will go more faster and more smoother for international and foreign arbitral awards. Now, we do have a few recourses. So what I think there's the obvious enforcement and recognition. There's the setting aside procedure. But then there's also the objection, to object to the award after the court has agreed to enforce the award. So this is something that is in a very limited time limit, on very small and limited grounds, where parties can actually object to the enforcement. So that is what I think is quite a bit of a novelty. But setting aside and enforcement, you know, were quite normal. Now, the biggest challenge that we have in Ethiopia is recognition. Our law, our practice, although our law has recognition, our practice does not have recognition. You know, if you're either enforcing the award, it's execution, or you're not doing anything with it. So it's that recognition part is really even a concept that judges are struggling to grapple with.
Okay, thanks. Very interesting. On the in a WADA area, Khaled, on Serge.
Okay, I'm going to begin. Yes, there are so many requests. The first is, as you have mentioned, the request for enforcement. And at this level, there is distinction to be made. And it depends if the arbitral award is from an arbitration center, which is found in WADA member state. In this case, the enforcement will be by virtue of an executive procedure, which is requested and granted by the competent court. Generally, and in the context of Cameroon, it is the president of court of first instance. Now, the second hypothesis is where the arbitral award is from an arbitral tribunal of the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration. And in this case, the CCJA, the court itself, has exclusive jurisdiction to enforce, to grant the exequatur. But in the context of Cameroon, like certainly in the context of any other country, because the Secretary General of the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration will issue a certified through coping and give the relevant document, but in order to enforce it practically within the specific country, you will need to obtain what we call the formula executoire. This is the executory formula which give to any bailiff the power to effectively enforce. And in Cameroon, there is a decree which was issued and which gives the possibility to the chief chief registrar of the Supreme Court of Cameroon to grant this formula executoire. And the third hypothesis is where the arbitral award is of foreign origin in bracket. And in this case, we have a specific law, a law of 2007, which provide that we have a specific judge, which is the juge en charge du contentieux de l'exécution, who is competent to order the exequatur. And then you have the records for the annulment, yes, as we commonly know it. And again, we have to make some distinction In the case, the seat of the arbitral tribunal is one of our member states. Generally, Article 25 provides for this possibility. In Cameroon, because again, in each of the country, the national legislator, the parliament has taken a bill to appoint the authorities which will receive those requests. And in Cameroon, it is the Court of Appeal. Caleb will certainly tell us what it's about when it's come to the to Ivory Coast. And when we have an arbitral award from the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration, it is the Common Court of Justice and of Arbitration which can rule on that. Now, other recourse, yes, under OADA law, there is a possibility to have other recourse like la tierce opposition. This is the third opposition, meaning that if the arbitral award has an influence on interest of third party, it is possible that those third party engage in action in order to request that the arbitral tribunal review the situation. And we also have what we call the recours en révision under our law. So that is what I can say for now. Khaled, you certainly complete.
It's great, Khaled. Yes, what to add after Serge? Yes, we can confirm that we have this Article 25, giving also a limit for the opposition and all the recourse proceeding, including the appeal and the appeal in front of the Supreme Court against an award, an arbitration award. But pertaining to the situation when the competent court refused to grant enforcement to a decision, at this time, one procedure is open. It will be if we are on the states of OADA area, the only procedure open will be in front of the CCJA. So at this time, the judge of the exequatur procedure, when he refused the enforcement to a decision because the only conditions mentioned by our internal rules is this award, arbitration award is, contrary of the public or international public order, at this time you can file the request in front of the CCJA and be able to plead and to defend the arbitration award in front of the CCJA. So it's mainly the same procedure, and if the center of CCJA, the arbitration tribunal, is held on this center, at this time the sentence will be filed when the request of annulment and all the time frame, the time frame has finished. At this time you have to say the clerk of the Supreme Court of Supreme Court in the OADA countries to ask him the enforcement formula. So this is the same procedure in all the states of OADA law.
I have a question before ask Rob. Do you have experience of tierce opposition? Because it's very, very rare. To be honest, I never seen a tierce opposition of a war. So I'm very interested by your experience about this. It's not exactly a recourse against the war, but it's an action. I would like to have more information about your experience about tierce opposition.
We have faced such procedure in Senegal, and fortunately, this procedure has been rejected by the appeal court. And a third party to this arbitration award has seized the appeal court of Dakar, asking the annulment of the arbitration award. So, fortunately, for many arguments, and we cannot, of course, disclose, this position has been rejected, and it's a final decision in our favor.
Okay. Good. Excellent. So, Robert, could you give us some explanation about your recourse, enforcement, annulment in South Africa?
Absolutely. I think just to start with, I think it's probably worth pointing out that it's setting aside an award, an arbitral award in South Africa is very difficult. I'll speak across the domestic context and then again the international context, because there's a slight difference in approach. There's four ways in which an award can be set aside. Domestic arbitrations, that's where the one is misconduct of the arbitral tribunal, gross irregularity, where the arbitral tribunal has exceeded their mandate, or where the award has been improperly obtained. So you can see the very nature of those reasons makes it quite difficult to set aside an award. Effectively, you need to show a severe breach of due process, and it's quite a difficult threshold in practice. In practice, we see very limited successful set aside proceedings. The court is precluded from inquiring into the merits of the matter. They can only look at whether the procedure was fair. Effectively, the question is, was the arbitrator's decision reasonably arrived at? And if the answer to that is yes, regardless of the merits, the award can't be set aside. In an international context, it's fairly similar. But as I said earlier, we've recently incorporated the model law, which has a couple more grounds, although frankly, they are fairly similar in practice. The model law also has the exceeding of mandate. There are a couple of others. For example, tribunal was not constituted in the manner agreed by the parties. Another is lack of notice of the arbitration. So again, we see these kind of fundamental issues being the only ones that may assist a defendant, an unsuccessful defendant, setting aside an arbitral award. And it goes hand in hand with recognition. Those same grounds, when countering a recognition application, can be raised by a respondent. Again, the success rate is low.
Okay. Thank you. We have 10 minutes. I would like to have two questions. The first is the impact of the annulment of an award at the seat of arbitration. What is the impact for you in your countries? For example, it's a different country. If there is an annulment of the award, for example, in France or in Europe in general, what is the effect of this annulment in your countries? Leilu?
Yes. You know, this is I think a very advanced question for the state in which our legal system is at the moment, or at least the practice of arbitration is at the moment. It depends from judge to judge. And some judges are actually very open to reviewing, to, you know, enforcing the award if the grounds upon which you know, the award can be set aside, if there's no particular challenge that can be presented against the award. But there is I'd say there's curiosity, particularly in this is really the difference between primary and secondary jurisdiction, really. I don't think it's a school of thought matter, but it's actually really a matter of, I'd say, solidarity with other courts, potentially with other judges, with regards to the enforcement. But it really will matter from a judge to judge perspective. And our courts haven't had that experience. And the reason our courts haven't had that experience is particularly an international arbitration for an foreign arbitral award, is because the application for enforcement of foreign arbitral awards is very limited. Enforcement usually goes outside. It's against assets of whether, you know, because our states usually state entities or governments that are involved in these large construction arbitration cases. And these cases usually go outside for the enforcement to be against the government or the state or entity. And it would be much easier to enforce it. It would be clear that the court would be.
Okay, thanks a lot. And in Hawada, Serge on Khaled, what is your answer to this question, which is the question of the characteristic of the arbitration under French law? We have a universal vocation of arbitration. So do you share this view in Hawada?
I
I certainly have missed something. I thought the question was to know which will be the effect of the annulment of the award. Is that correct?
Yes, the annulment of award in one country, and then the impact and the effect in other countries of the annulment. For example, in France, there is no effect.
In no other country, if we refer to an arbitral award issued by a tribunal fund in our zone, normally, if the award has been declared null and void, it shall be incumbent to the parties, to the most diligent, to re-engage arbitration. So normally it shall have no effect, whether in Cameroon or in any other country. If it is a decision which deny or which refuse executor, Khaled has already said it, then there is a possibility to go before the CCJR and so on. But I don't think we are on this aspect. If it is an arbitral award of the CCJR, what again, there will be no effect, but the CCJR can rehear the matter and rule on the merit if the party is so request. So it will be for one of the party to reintroduce the matter.
Okay. Alors, in South Africa, I would like to explain exactly the question, because it's maybe a French question, to be honest. It's due to the universal vocation of French law. I quote a French decision, well-known French decision: international awards which are not connected to any national legal order are an international judicial decision whose validity must be examined with regard to the rules applicable in the country where its recognition and enforcement are sought. So it's why there is no effect of an annulment of an award in one country in France. So it's why I'm interested by this question, because it's very rare. And I would like to discuss with you, I think it's a very useful question, a practical question for the development of arbitration in Africa. So it's why now I would like to have the answer to this general question in South Africa. Robert?
Sure. I think this is one of those questions where the answer is very much it depends. And I think one would need to look at the reason for that annulment. I haven't dealt with such a matter, but I can imagine an application being brought, or a counter application being brought in a recognition proceedings, explaining that the award has been annulled in another country and putting forward those reasons. And if the reasons for that annulment would be consistent with the South African court's line of thinking, and they may have annulled it on the same basis, I could imagine that application might be successful. It may even be put forward under the guise of public policy, given that we seem to be dealing with the foreign arbitral award, and that is obviously one of the exceptions, one of the express exceptions in the UNCITRAL law, which can be relied on. So I think unfortunately it's one of those nebulous kind of answers that I've given, but it could probably go either way, depending on the facts and the circumstances.
Okay, thanks. On your answer is a bridge to the last question about the definition of breach of international public policy. Can one conclude that the review of international public policy by state courts in your country is extensive or restrictive? It's also very interesting to appreciate the efficiency of the arbitration process. Leiru?
It's very interesting because of the perception that judges have in my discussion with them, perception of judges have of them sometimes. And so this is a discussion, you know, it's kind of, I think there's two schools of thought. There's a group of judges that believe that they are there to protect the public interest. And as such, public policy should actually be wider. And there's a group of judges that say, well, parties are free to make their agreement. Public policy should actually be very much limited to really, really specific issues. And I really think there's going to be a complete battle between judges on that ground. We so far don't have an extensive definition of public policy. It's been quite narrow. But I think time will tell on how that will evolve.
Okay, thanks. Hello, Hino Hada.
Yes, I will say on this point that and my position is based on a decision which was rendered by the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration in October 2016 in a matter opposing the company named Oryx Benin SA versus ADN Gaz SAL. I think this is one of the decisions where the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration has to respond to a party who raised the violation of various international legal public law. And I think it was two rules, the principle of contradictoire, the principe du contradictoire, and then one rules which was contained in the internal bars rules. The comments which derive from this decision from the Common Court of Justice and Arbitration is that the interpretation of our Supreme Court in matter of OADA law is to give effect to favorize, to give effect to enforcement procedure. So I will conclude, I will say that our court generally takes a pro-enforcement stance in respect of arbitration. Okay, based on that decision. I don't know, Khaled, if you have other decisions. Okay.
Yes, on Khaled, do you have some comments to add?
Yes. Yes, particularly concerning this point, of course, CCJA is the Supreme Court of 17 countries. But what we are noting that, you know, security of procedures in front of all our jurisdictions are not totally, you know, granted, because when a country is rejecting a request of annulment and the claimant is, you know, searching to seize other assets in other country, these other jurisdictions could take, you know, the decision, I mean, the decision in a sovereign position, but this decision could be the opposing decision to another country. So there is no there is no common position between different jurisdictions in terms of, you know, sovereign appreciation of the international public policy. So it's very difficult in our, you know, OHADA zone to be able, you know, to have a common position on this appreciation and interpretation.
Yes, but Khaled, what I wanted to say is that while, in fact, and it is true, national judge will have a tendency to raise the international policy rules in order to avoid to eject the enforcement of arbitral award. I'm saying, and from this decision, that the Common Court of Arbitration sanctions abuses from those state court, those internal courts, which may have a tendency to not be, let's say like that, pro-arbitral enforcement.
But we both know that we are facing many, many issues and many, many problems in front of our jurisdictions, local jurisdictions, and that's why each jurisdiction is, you know, taking this point completely independently from another. So that's why I'm talking about sovereign, you know, appreciation coming from different jurisdictions.
In Europe, it's the same. It's very difficult to answer clearly to this question about the scope of the international public policy. It's always a question. In the South Africa, because we have that just at the end of this roundtable, so you have a few some minutes, maybe 1 or 2 minutes, to answer to this question in South Africa.
I think, yeah, I mean, public policy also presents a difficulty in interpretation, much like my colleagues on the panel have mentioned, and it does tend to differ from case to case. However, I think I do think that the, again, I think I said this earlier, but the South African approach has been to construe it more narrowly, and I think they apply, well, arguably apply, there is some divergent case law on this point, but they arguably apply the principle of international public policy as opposed to domestic public policy, which is a slightly narrower formulation than domestic public policy. So I think that's, I'll leave it at that for now, given the time.
Thanks a lot for the, I'm sorry for the short time, but maybe some attendees have questions in the room. Don't hesitate to ask your question in French or in English, and all our panelists will be very happy to answer. No comments, no questions?
No, no, there are questions, there are questions. I also have a question.
So,
Thank you to the panelists and to the fantastic moderators. As the sub-regional coordinator of Francophone Africa, I'm very proud of this panel. Took a few weeks to put it together. But I have a question maybe for Leyu. We spoke extensively about enforcement this afternoon, and the African continent as a whole, forgetting it is plus 50 countries, has somewhat bad press when it comes to enforcement. What would be your advice to, you know, decision makers and lawmakers and, you know, governments to improve, let's say, the marketability of Africa when it comes to enforcement, the image? Because oftentimes, you know, we see that, and we see it today, a lot of countries have bad press when it comes to enforcement, but when you look at the statistics or the cases, it's not as bad as we think it is. Over to you, Leia.
Thank you so much for that question. Yes, the truth is we really have what we would call a bad rap when it comes to our courts. And you know, and it's great that we have Robert in on the panel. It's, you know, South Africa. It's actually, you know, the constitutional law of South Africa and the legal system of South Africa is actually a model legal system in terms of a very independent judiciary. And, you know, again, South Africa being one of the leading countries and economically very large, does not see as many enforcement reform ethical awards as, let's say, you know, you know, we did a research with IF where we saw that in a year, Paris gets over 8,000 applications. I think this was about in 2008 or so, 1,000 applications of foreign arbitral awards, you know, non-Paris, but foreign arbitral awards. And that number was not, we couldn't find that amount of foreign arbitral awards being enforced in, you know, 10 to 15 African countries with which we did the research on. And the idea and the constant view is that, you know, courts aren't independent enough, and you never know if they're really going to allow this or not allow that. I mean, I think there's two aspects to this. The first is when it comes to state-owned entities, and the second one is commercial entities. The truth is African courts and African judges are actually very keen in enforcing and are actually very pro enforcement. And there's a lot of data to actually show that. So I think what we should do is you know, publish that data more and more and speak of our courts honestly in terms of their position and provide visibility for our judges who are actually making these decisions. So the translation, and I mean, there's a linguistic barrier as well in some countries. to, and also access to resources were not as available. So I think those are elements. So in terms of policymakers, I would say make it public. Publish your court decisions related to arbitration, and let the lawyers see that in fact for arbitration and a lot for arbitration and a lot of people. So that would be my answer. Thank you very much.
So there is another question. Yes. I believe it's your last. Okay, you have a question.
Thank you very much to everyone on the panel. That's been very interesting. I've got a question in relation to TS Opposition and something that, speaking as a common lawyer, I find somewhat baffling. And I wonder if you could help me with some of the practicalities. In the event that a third-party opposition to an arbitral award was successful, what then happens? Is the decision remitted back to the tribunal, or do the parties need to convene a new tribunal and conduct the entire arbitration again? Or would it simply be limited to the aspect of the decision and submissions on those parts which impacted the third party, and the rest of it would remain intact? Could somebody help me with the practicalities of what happens if a third party successfully opposes an award?
I've not yet had the opportunity to experience this procedure. I think Khaled, who has had the opportunity, will explain us. But from my perspective, I think that it will be good that the parties again recommend the procedure before the arbitral tribunal, because that is the principle before the state court. In our judicial system, you can only engage a tierce opposition before the judge which has rendered the decision. So in my opinion, we are referring to an arbitral award issued by a tribunal, an arbitral tribunal. So normally, if a third party is of the opinion that it has an influence on its interest, it should normally bring the matter again to that tribunal arbitral. To that, yes.
Yes, in addition, I mean, for the third opposition, what we can know that it's permitted that, you know, this jurisdiction would have competence if, of course, in the absence of arbitration tribunal. So this third party could say, if the decision is rendered in favor of this third party, depending from the content of the decision, what we have faced is, I mean, the arguments of this party, third party, has been rejected because it was a sister company of a holding company, and this sister company has introduced this third opposition. But for many reasons and arguments, this position has been rejected. And today we can anticipate, depending from the content of the third decision and the content of this decision, if there is a direct consequence on, you know, what we call the relation between the claimant and the defendant, it could be, I mean, against the award arbitration or in the sense of the award arbitration. If it's against, at this time, of course, the claimant, if we are engaging this procedure in front of the arbitration tribunal, we have to reinitiate the process. We are facing this problem, and we will talk after. We cannot disclose, but one name in Côte d'Ivoire. We are facing, you know, not a third opposition, but we are going to introduce a request for annulment. And it's mainly due to the management coming from the center of arbitration. So at this point, we can discuss after.
Okay. So.
So Khaled, your third opposition was engaged before the arbitral tribunal, right? No, so before the, after, but before the Court of Appeal or before the arbitral tribunal?
After the award arbitration, and for many reasons, this request has been rejected from the appeal court. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a question for Teyo. Leo, sorry. Leo, please, I want you to explain us something. I've heard from you and I've noticed that under your law, it is possible for an arbitral tribunal to order attachment of assets. While in our context, it is pretty clear that and under Article 14 of the Uniform Act, that it is not possible for an arbitral tribunal to take such measure. These are only the competence of the state court. And I think, Khaled, this is a change which occurred after the revision of the Uniform Act. Because when I was in 2002, I write my art diploma, the theme of my memoir of the year was on les mesures provisoires et conservatoires en matière ouada. And at this time, my opinion was that there was not such provision, Article 14, and I was pleading that the arbitral tribunal should be able to order attachment and guarantee. But there was an issue. What then? After, what do we need to do? Certainly go and request again the exequatur or not? So please, how does it work in your context after this arbitral tribunal has ordered the attachment of the asset of a party?
Merci, Serge. Yeah, it's actually quite a novelty for us as well. So, you know, the idea is there's specific grounds upon which interim measures can be made by the arbitral tribunal, and one of them is to preserve assets or to preserve funds, you know, either directly or for them to be put under with a third party. And you're right, what will have to happen is you will have to now take this to court and the court will have to enforce it. But the good thing about this is the recognition and enforcement of interim measures is actually quite swift. And there's very limited ground upon which the court can actually refuse the enforcement of this. So it really, really goes directly to what exequatur, practically just directly goes into execution. So you still need the court, but the tribunal will be able to make that decision for you, and you won't have to have any, you know, your application is only to enforce it and not to do otherwise. And if I can say one more thing about the third party intervention, I know that it's a very interesting thing. And to be honest, a lot of judges in Ethiopia really struggle with that because there's a lot of application for third party in litigation, but also in arbitration. And this law actually addresses, our new law addresses this. And what it says is, and it's very fascinating, so I don't know how this is going to work. I'm still to come across one, is that the third party intervention is at the arbitral, you know, it's during the arbitration proceeding. And in order for the third party to intervene in the arbitral process, there has to be consent by the third party and both parties of the arbitration. So I don't quite see how that's actually going to happen. And I think this is, you know, fait accompli, doomed from the very beginning in my view.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Any question? No? Because we have received the instruction that we have to stay in 1 hour and we have 15 minutes over. It's the evidence that the panelists were excellent, and thanks for them. And thanks warmly to our panelists. Peter, maybe you could conclude, make some words of conclusion. You are mute, Peter. No. Sorry.
Strange. Just to say warm thanks to all of our panelists. And I think we understand that there is going to be some sort of drinks that will follow. I think the panelists should prepare themselves for questions on third-party intervention. I think you're going to get a few of those. So good luck. Good luck with your drinks. But a very warm thanks to each of our panelists. That was great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Okay. I think we can. Thank you.